In this video, I'm returning to my health problems that I had in my 50s and how I came to accept, finally, that statins were the cause of them. And I'm also going to discuss the incompetent, if not outright unethical, approach that my own doctor took. Stay tuned. In a previous video, I listed 8 things that started happening to me in my 50s, and I had connected 2 of them kind of tenuously to the use of statins, the morning queasiness and the mental fog and depression, but I still wasn't convinced yet. So I went to my doctor, of course, with this observation that I was experiencing these cognitive effects from the statins, and she went through at least the first 2 stages, traditional stages of grief. She started with denial. These are not caused by statins, she told me. Outright, flat out, these are not caused by statins. And then she started to get a little angry because I asked if possibly the reason that my cholesterol shot up to worse than it was before I went on statins was just because maybe there's a rebound effect, maybe my liver having been prevented from producing cholesterol for so long, once the emergency brake was taken off by getting rid of the statins, it just produced cholesterol. She told me immediately, right out, your cholesterol's gone way back up and there's no such thing as a rebound effect. I'll address that one first. That was a dishonest answer because the correct answer was, we don't know. Nobody's ever studied that. I have looked high and low for a study that would confirm or refute that. Now, I finally did find something that came out years after this conversation in which if you extracted the data, you could look at it and say, no, there really isn't such an effect. But I thought it was a reasonable question and I felt that she was just going to say anything. I mean, just the fact that she answered the question so fast indicated to me that she hadn't thought it through. She was just going to give whatever answer was going to make me stop objecting and be a good boy and take the medications that she was giving me. Now, notice the year that this happened, and we're going to get back to that first point in a moment. 2 years earlier, the FDA had put out this position, adverse event information. I'll read through it and I'm going to interpret as we go along. Information about the potential for generally non-serious, that is a value judgment. I don't think that they actually should be saying that they are non-serious. I think that's up to the individual patient to determine if they're serious or non-serious. And reversible, that's another point that we can argue because, yeah, it did seem to be reversible for me ultimately, but if I was on them for 20 or 30 years, would these effects have been reversible? Who knows? By that time, I would have been in my late 70s, they would have just written it off as age. Continue on. Cognitive side effects, memory loss, confusion, etc., has been added to the statin label. I wasn't one to read all the fine print on the medications. Maybe I should have. I should have been a better patient. But the doctor should have known about this, and either she did know about it and was treating me unethically, or she didn't know about it, and then I have to ask, why? Is there a competence issue there? The FDA continues. FDA continues to believe, another value-laden term, they believe that the cardiovascular benefits of statins outweigh these small increased risks. From a clinical population study, maybe that's the case. From the point of view of the individual, that's definitely not the case. There are different viewpoints on this, and I found this probably a couple years after it was written, an article in the Journal of the American Medical Association. It was a letter to the editor sort of thing in the December 2014 edition. Jonathan McDonagh wrote an article from a patient's perspective, statin-related cognitive impairment in the real world. You'll live longer, but you might not like it. So he was conceding that statins may allow you to live longer, may give you some cardiovascular benefit. But he was experiencing the same cognitive impairments that I was. I mean, I read the article and I felt like a great weight had been lifted off my shoulders, that I wasn't alone. I felt very alone up to that. I'd been arguing with a doctor, a little bit of white coat syndrome on my part, started to give in to what she was telling me. It's in retrospect that I realized how unfairly I had been treated. In this article, he even points out, even if people know that they're experiencing cognitive impairment, it's not exactly intuitive to connect a heart medication with brain problems. And that was the thing that I was having a problem doing. I can remember walking through the halls at work and saying, I don't see how this can be, but I know it is. I just know it is. Well, he confirmed it for me. Now, I'm not going to put up the whole article. It's really important for people to read. I will leave a link to it in the description, and I encourage everybody to go out and read everything that Mr. McDonagh had to say. So in 2017, the August edition of the Annals of Internal Medicine, there was an editorial penned by a prominent cardiologist entitled Statin Denial, an Internet-Driven Cult with Deadly Consequences. I couldn't read the article itself. It was behind a paywall. I don't like to encourage these people by actually paying them money to read insulting things. And in fact, since I'm going by secondary sources, I hope and I'm giving an honest attempt to represent the viewpoint here, but I don't want to put the name out there. You can find it yourself if you're interested. I just don't want to go there. But this is a representative opinion of the medical field, and I'm sure they would consider this YouTube channel to be part of that internet-driven cult. So in that issue of the Annals of Internal Medicine, there was a study in which 28,266 patients with adverse effects from statins were followed up 4 years later to see how they fared. 29.3% of them, 8,282, stopped their statin prescription because of possible adverse effects. So in other words, there wasn't even an acknowledgement that they were actual adverse effects, but there was at least an acknowledgement that the patients thought they had these adverse effects. So after 4 years, here were the negative outcomes. Now, a negative outcome is somebody had a heart attack. They may have survived, they may not have survived. That actually wasn't part of the data. People who still had their statin prescription had 12.2% cardiovascular events within 4 years. That's actually very high. Now, the number in the brackets is my estimate of what it would be after 10 years. I prefer to always give the same time basis for any figures we're talking about. So it would be about 28%. That's an extremely high risk group. Those who didn't have their statin prescription, it was 13.9%, or an estimate of 32% after 10 years, who had these events. Now, the number needed to treat in those cases is 59, or about 25. These are very high risks. 32% of 1 out of 3 risks that you're going to have a heart attack within the next 10 years, that's very high, so let's just keep that in mind. You should notice that the relative risk reduction that you can calculate from these two figures, the 13.9% of the people not taking the prescription and the 12.2% of the people who had the prescription, is only about 12.5%. That's far lower relative risk reduction than what we've seen. You know, the advertisements always said something like 36%, some said probably more, some probably said less. But I always take 36% because that's the famous one that was advertised the most. There's maybe several reasons why the relative risk reduction was only about 12.5%. First of all, it may not apply as robustly to high-risk patients and that these figures are perfectly legitimate. And if that's the case, well, okay, we have to deal with it. It's possible that patients experiencing adverse effects, they simply may not benefit as much. Maybe there's something about their biology that says, oh, we have these effects instead of getting the benefits. Possibility too. You know, it's an on average thing. It's also possible that the positive effects of having been on statins for many years before they got off them, it had some residual effects. That's a possibility, and if the reason I have this in red here is because that's saying the people who are no longer have a statin prescription, their number could really have been legitimately even higher, and that may account for some of the reason why the relative risk reduction seems so low. And then finally, and I think this is the most likely explanation, many of the patients in the group that had prescriptions for statins may not have actually been taking them. This study, they admitted that they had no way of following up and figuring out what the compliance level was in the people with the prescription group. So all these factors confuse matters. In general, I think what they indicate is that this difference between the two groups is actually kind of a lower limit, and the difference could have been bigger. So in other words, I'm giving a little more credit to statins than the data necessarily shows. So here's a value judgment from the CNN article, quoting the researchers. Taken together, that's a 1.7% difference in these negative outcomes, the researchers noted. And again, I've extrapolated to about 4% over 10 years. And our prominent cardiologist is quoted as indicating that's a very significant number. Well, is 1.7% really that significant? Well, a mathematician would say that's significant because it's extremely likely that the effect is real. But that's not passing any judgment on whether the effect is meaningful or worthwhile. But in fairness, that 1.7%, if you were to somehow could identify the people who would have had a heart attack and didn't because they continued taking their statin, after 4 years, that number comes up to about 340 people. And I've extrapolated, it's about 800 people, again, after 10 years. And if you put them in an auditorium and you announce to them, you people were going to have heart attacks in the past 4 years or past 10 years, but you didn't, because you took this medication. There would be a standing ovation for whoever it was that encouraged them to take this medication. They were presumably saved. But what we're ignoring is that there's 2,438 people, or over 10 years, 5,595 people outside the auditorium. Some of them are 6 feet under. Some of them are confined to hospital beds or nursing home beds. Some of them are in wheelchairs because they had strokes. Far more people weren't helped at all. And then there's the huge group of people who weren't going to have them anyway. There are a lot of people who are still not benefiting. From the point of view of the cardiologist, well, he puts it here. He said, those kinds of numbers are typically what we see for very effective treatments. That's the medical field tipping its hand. They consider a 4% absolute improvement over 10 years, or 1.7%, which was really what he's talking about, over 4 years, to be a very effective treatment. There are still four times as many people not helped by the treatment who have those heart attacks. There are still 24 out of 25 aren't helped by the treatments, either because they weren't going to have a heart attack anyway, or because they had a heart attack despite the medicine. That's considered very effective by these people. Why? Because they're looking at the total number saved, and they're treating it as a population thing. In other words, they can sit back and say, look at that, all those lives were saved. Well, what about the lives that weren't saved? People were given a false sense of hope. What about the people who had the adverse effects, whose lives were essentially ruined or the quality of life was greatly reduced? I don't know how many that is. I think it's about 20%. So 80% of the people that's not going to apply to, but there are a huge number of people suffering from the side effects. So I'm going to give the final word here to Mr. McDonagh. And he was addressing the doctors in this part of his letter. And in it, he said, your patients may not see the statin equation in the same way that you do. In other words, your patients look at it from the point of view of individuals. The medical profession looks at it from the point of view of population studies. Those are clashes of values. And I think he summed it up best with his closing statement. We're the experts on what we value. In my case, I valued being able to think clearly. I valued being able to hike hundreds of miles. That's something I can do now. That's something I could do before I was on statins. That's not something I could do while I was on statins. In the end, I think what we're talking about is a clash in values. Now, in my next video, I'm actually going to go into where I stand now with all of the 8 problems that I was experiencing in my 50s and where I am now that I'm off statins. So thanks for listening. And if you haven't watched this video, I recommend that you take a look at it now.